The elephant in the room has now started to trumpet loud. So let's talk about Pegasus and India's general problems with surveillance. 1 year ago, on 30th October 2019, news first broke out that at least 24 human rights defenders in India, including activists, academics, journalists, and lawyers, were targeted using a highly sophisticated military-grade spyware called Pegasus, which was developed by Israel-based NSO group. But how does it work? Pegasus targets users by exploiting a vulnerability in WhatsApp and gains complete access to a device by getting the user to click on a link or through a missed call. The revelations led to widespread outrage, especially since the targets of surveillance were human rights defenders. Now here's the tricky part. The NSO group claims that it only sold Pegasus to vetted government entities, so this is definitely not the work of a random evil genius bored at home, and in all probability involves our government, or worse still, that of another country's. Despite concerns raised by organizations like Access Now, Amnesty International, Committee to Protect Journalists, and the Internet Freedom Foundation, nothing really came of it. State governments like that of Chhattisgarh denied involvement of police officials, and the only official body that provided a hearing to the victims of the Pegasus hack then was the Parliamentary Standing Committee on Information Technology. But we're still waiting on a report from their findings. So what can the spyware do? Well, almost anything a device is vulnerable to sophisticated spyware and therefore can potentially breach any and all of your personal data. We're talking real-time monitoring of calls, collection of emails, social media posts, call logs, even messages on encrypted chat apps. It can even tell your location, what direction you're moving in. Kind of like having access to everything on a person's phone without them having a hint of it. But why are we talking about this again? Because on July 18, 2021, The Wire, as part of an international collaborative investigation called Pegasus Project, revealed that the Israeli spyware firm NSO targeted over 300 verified Indian mobile telephone numbers, including those used by ministers, opposition leaders, journalists, the legal community, businessmen, government officials, scientists, right activists, and others. The revelation was made on the basis of a leaked database accessed by Paris-based media nonprofit Forbidden Stories and Amnesty International, that, by the way, halted its operations in the country in 2020 after all the bank accounts of the organization were frozen by the government. Subsequent reporting by The Wire and Washington Post revealed that the forensic analysis conducted by Amnesty International's security lab was able to confirm that the Pegasus spyware was used to compromise the phones of multiple leading journalists, with potential targets including opposition leader Rahul Gandhi, current IT minister Ashwini Vaishnaw, and the woman who had accused former CJI Ranjan Gogoi of sexual harassment. So why should we be so concerned? Government of India, in response to a questionnaire sent by the Pegasus Project, stated that the allegations regarding the government surveillance on specific people has no concrete basis or truth associated with it whatsoever. The problem with this response isn't just that it is insufficient and fails to respond conclusively to the detailed reporting on the scandal. It was also the fact that no such power to hack the phones of Indian citizens exists under Indian law, and the pre-existing surveillance powers available under the Telegraph Act of 1885 and the IT Act of 2000 do not permit the installation of spyware or hacking mobile devices. Hacking of computer resources, including mobile phones and apps, is in fact a criminal offense under the IT Act of 2000, and it is only through such hacking that the Pegasus spyware can be used against a person to begin with. The scandal has highlighted an issue that has been brewing for a while, especially the discussion around freedom of speech, the right to privacy, and the moral use of tech that does not and will never rightfully include the surveillance of journalists who are trying to do their jobs. This brings us to the need for urgent surveillance reform to protect the citizens against the use of such invasive technologies, which hamper their fundamental rights to privacy and threatens the democratic ideals of our country. Use of such surveillance technology on journalists leads to a chilling effect, as it precludes them from working and reporting on sensitive matters, some of which may also be against the ruling government, without jeopardizing themselves and their personal safety. while the IFF will continue to report on the story and work towards the surveillance reform and examine avenues for further engagement with all branches of the government, legislative, executive, and judicial, it is important for us to realize why such a possible ruling party-sponsored surveillance problem is not just betraying the democratic idols of our country, but even at a personal level for all of us, deeply threatening to our voices. As India works towards digital reform and attempts to bridge the digital divide in our country, the possible victims of such attacks will only continue to increase and could possibly one day include you and I. Whatever comes, let's not settle for that.